Good morning, everyone.
Thank you.
Indicative.
Turn me up.
Come and worship.
Good morning there.
Hi,
how are you all this morning? Does anybody know what this is?
A trumpet, you're right, yes. And that little song, it wasn't a whole big song, that little bit that I played, you know what that's called? That's called a fanfare. Have you ever heard the word fanfare? You have?
They're on their way to New York. If I understood it correctly, Joan's mother, Mrs. Burkenstock, is not moving. had no idea they had it. So the Bermudez family, they sent me a note yesterday saying they'll be back here just as soon as they can, as soon as they heal, and they miss you. And I said the same word back to them, so thank you for being part of that. Shirley Marner was with us this morning. She's not been feeling well this fall, but she was good enough to be, kind enough to be with us here this morning. Eski Straka has injured her foot. She had a very severe swelling in her foot. She could be here this morning as well. So those names, if you would please, the Butler family, the May family, Bermudez family, Shirley, and Eski Straka. So let me turn to you and ask you, are there joys and or concerns you would like to share with us this morning? Simply hold up your hand. Bring the microphone. Really want to get to that finger food dinner, don't you? Jane's got something right here.
I'm just going to remind you of this joy of all these gifts back here by our Christmas tree. And thank you for taking the little boys and girl dolls and bringing the gifts back and remembering that next Sunday they must all be here. Thank you.
Last call. You would be kind enough to take something at the hand of somebody to see you. It's a magnificent time for us to be in our church and our synagogues around the world today as we move into the second Sunday of the Advent season. We prepare our hearts, we prepare our minds, and our souls, our families, our church, for the coming of the Christ child. For the concerns and joys of our church with the Butler family and Ron May and Mrs. Birkenstock, or the Bermudez family, Shirley and Eski, for Christmas gifts coming and going, for the arrival of those who have taken the clothesline children and have accomplished your shopping at this time, for the bringing in of Christmas that will be done with the children's program in just a few moments. Many wonderful things that are happening around our church and around our world. For the concerns of our hearts, our church, our community, our state, our nation, and our world, we uplift and uphold all of these concerns as we recite the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would you be kind enough to stand with me, please? Let's find somebody that you've not yet greeted and welcome them to this worship hour. Thank you.
Thank you.
blessed Redeemer, as you rescued your people of old, so you rescue us over and over again. Like a refiner's fire and a fuller's soap, you have purified our lives like the works of fine silver and gold. From the brightness of your dawn, we bring our offering to you this day, that those who sit in darkness may find these gifts light and hope, compassion and love. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
We are going to be lighting the second of the Advent candles. Jim and Chris Crosby are coming. If you look at the back page of the bulletin, you'll find the responsive reading. Kind enough to stand with me on the back page of your bulletin to see our special lesson. Also, don't miss your dream. And read with me, please, as we find this to be inspired. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod the Tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, Tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Licinius, Tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptizing of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked road shall become straight, and the rough ways smooth. And all people will seek God's salvation.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Won't you be seated, please? Be with me, please, in a moment of prayer. Let's pray our eyes. Thank you for these quiet moments. It's been a hectic week for a lot of you. Coming and going, busy schedules, programs to meet, practices, gift buying, gift wrapping. Just glad to be here. We ask the power of the Holy Spirit to give us this calm spirit. We can handle this extremely busy season. We want to also not neglect the soul that we have that needs to be we hear him clearly after 2100 years. Call to repentance is still the call to John, Jesus, and the church. We give you thanks. We're asking you to be with us by the power of your Holy Spirit as we prepare ourselves for today. In Jesus' name we pray. I, like you, am totally aware that just about every man, woman, and child on the face of this planet has their own priorities. We have our own mission. My priorities are different from yours. Yours are different from mine. This group is different from this group. This group is different from that. We're looking at priorities this morning, but I want us to see there is a tombstone in Wisconsin that this guy's priority. His name was on there, and his birth date, birth year, and his deceased year. And below that, he wanted everybody to know that he pulled a 300 in 1982. That was his priority. You bowlers may understand that. Anybody ever been to a yard sale? All of us? Okay. Lady was at a yard sale and she was looking over the items that were being offered for sale, and she says to the owner, she said, "I think my husband's going to be very angry with me when he finds out that I've been to your yard sale." The proprietor says, in an effort to try to calm her soul, he says, "Oh, I think your husband will be okay with this once he finds out all the bargains that you have found." She said, "Well, typically that's true, but you see, he just broke his leg and he's waiting for me to come home and take him to the hospital." Where was her priority? Scripture lesson this morning is about priorities. It's about a person who believed that he was the one and only person that had a priority to bring the message that Jesus Christ was coming into the world. His name was John the Baptist. He is the son of Zechariah. He happened to be one of the temple elders at that particular time. Here are these words again from Luke, how he describes John's priority. "The word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness, and he went into all the country around the Jordan River, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the words of Isaiah. John was the voice of one calling in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in. Every mountain and hill be made low. The crooked road shall become straight, and the rough way smooth, and all the people will see the salvation of God.'" Central to John's life was this priority, to prepare the world for the coming of the Messiah. Now, it doesn't just stop with John. It's the message of the 21st century church. We are called. We are encouraged. We are talented, and we are blessed with the responsibility of telling our world about the coming of Jesus Christ. Now, it's all too easy for us to forget this missional fact. In ancient times, when a king was going to survey his properties, he would send an emissary out before him to herald the king was coming. This emissary would go into whatever city the king was planning to visit, and he would tell them, "The king is coming. He will be here any day. You need to clean up your lives and make sure that you are in obedience to the king's commands so he won't punish you when he arrives." Now, this emissary also became the city inspector for that short period of time. He would go around the city, he would make a list of things that needed to be fixed. He would tell the people, "You need to clean up your city. You need to sweep your streets. You need to get the garbage off the sidewalks. You need to round up the criminals. Let's make the city safe. You need to fix the roads. You need to smooth them out. You need to make them straight. You need to make sure that your town is gleaming, to make sure that it is fit for the king's arrival." It was an embarrassment. The city was not prepared when they came around. It was an insult to the king if they had not prepared properly for his arrival. John the Baptist came to announce the coming of a king, admittedly a different type of king. John was that voice in the wilderness saying, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his path. Every valley should be filled in, every mountain should be made low, crooked paths should be made straight, rough ways should be made smooth. And all the people will see God's salvation. Story is told about a great effort to straighten a highway in Southern California. It was old Highway 99, and it ran from the northern part of Los Angeles up about 110 miles to Bakersfield, California. Maybe some of you have been on that road. It went through this rugged Tehachapi mountain range, and it was, in fact, I Googled it, and I tried to find what that looked like, and that was part of the road until they straightened it out. Years ago, truck drivers would take their truck and would go up. It was a winding road, and it would go as high as 4,000 feet, and then it would drop down 4,000 feet. So the truck drivers had to continually shift gears, one going so slow up that they could cool their load, and then to have to shift down into lower gears to go downhill to keep the speed from going too fast for them. Fortunately, the government decided to do something about this treacherous piece of road beginning in 1960, and they didn't finish it until 1972. Highway 99 was upgraded to Interstate I-5, and it was one of the most impressive pieces of engineering in human history. Road cuts hundreds of feet deep were sliced through the mountain. The rocks and dirt were extracted from the mountains that they tore down and used to fill in the gorges in the canyon. Whenever one crosses over I-5 now, north of Los Angeles and 110 miles to Bakersfield, you cannot but help think of Isaiah's words, John's priority in preparation for the coming of the world, to make us literally fit for the coming of Jesus Christ. God is seeking to prepare both you and me to cut through the mountains of our pride, to fill in the valleys of our despair, to straighten out our crooked moral rationalizations, and to make us fit to receive the kingdom that is coming. That's why each year on the second Sunday of Advent, we revisit John the Baptist's words in his preaching in the wilderness. The leveling of the land is just literally a word picture, helping us to understand the way John's ministry paved the way for the coming of the Messiah. Now, admittedly, repentance is not necessarily a word that we typically tie to Christmas. After all, Christmas is this warm and fuzzy holiday. At Christmas, we like to think of God as a jolly old Saint Nicholas who forgives all and accepts all and would never hold us responsible for how we live our lives. Sometimes the last thing we want to think about is repentance. It's also difficult to combine a vision of a prophet out in the wilderness dressed in animal skins, eating locusts and wild honey, calling people to repentance in a society that barely acknowledges the concept of sin anymore. The television continues to trumpet. What goes on in Vegas stays in Vegas. It's a horrible theology. The word sin has lost its sting and has become a punchline. Tired old jokes. Meanwhile, thousands of women's lives are ended because of domestic violence. More than half of our nation's children now live in single-parent homes. Drug and alcohol addictions continue to soar among our young people. We know people who wander around with absolutely no moral compass in their lives anymore. Mass media spews out violence and obscenity and explicit portrayals of inappropriate impropriety, family fighting against family, the my way or highway attitude. Is there ever a greater need in our time to hear the word of repentance? John the Baptist was not fooling around. He lived in the wilderness around the Dead Sea. He subsisted on a starvation diet, and so did his disciples. His clothes were so raggedy that even rummage sale people would not have handled it. And when he preached, it was fire and brimstone. The kingdom was coming, all right, he said. But if you thought it was going to be a simple cup of tea, then you better think again. If you don't shape up, God would give you the axe like the elm tree with the blight, or toss you into the incinerator like the chaff. He said that being a Jew would not get you any more points than being a slave. And one of his most famous addresses to his own congregation is that he called them a snake pit. Your one and only hope, he said, was to clean up your life as if your eternal life depended on it. And it does. Getting baptized in a hurry, he said, as a sign that you are determined to become one of the followers of Jesus Christ. Some people thought that John was Elijah reincarnated. Others even thought he was the Messiah. But John would have neither said about him. He even said on more than one occasion, and I paraphrase, "I'm trying to knock some sense into your heads." We are preparing our homes for Christmas. Are we preparing our hearts? We're hanging up the Christmas lights, but are we ignoring the darkness in our own lives, the darkness of strained relationships, the darkness of moral weakness, the darkness of anger and hopelessness and despair, egotism, or the fear of the unknown? Maybe on the second Sunday of Advent, we need a little head knocking too. How many of you remember this show? It ran from 2003 to 2012, Extreme Makeover Home Edition. It's a heartwarming show that actually helped people fix up their homes, and back in about the mid-2000s, about this time of year, Extreme Makeover aired a story about Alice Harris and her South Central Los Angeles family. Now, the story is told about how the good people of the Extreme Makeover had decided to voluntarily demolish Alice's home. Seems like a year before, there was a flood in that particular area. Alice and her family, who had absolutely no insurance, were caused to move off the main floor, move up to the second floor, and all live in one room. The flood had also destroyed many Christmas gifts that she had collected to give to the kids of the Watts area of South Central Los Angeles. All the gifts were destroyed. Alice said, "I don't think anyone would come to the Watts and help us. No one had ever done that before. The Extreme Makeover did." Their staff shipped Alice and her family off for a week's vacation, while hundreds of volunteer workers and neighbors tore down her home and built her a brand new, bigger home. They replaced the toys, the Christmas gifts, donated items to, and gave her flood-stricken neighbors everything that they needed. They even threw in a basketball court for the kids to play on. Why do I tell you that story? John the Baptist wanted people to understand that the coming of the Messiah, the coming of Jesus Christ, would mean the coming of an extreme makeover. An extreme makeover. The day is still to come. The day when the poor will no longer be oppressed, when the hungry will all be fed, the naked will be clothed. The day when we will no longer take up arms against our fellow people. The day when children will no longer have to live in fear. You know what? You and I are called to that extreme makeover. We've been gifted. We've been talented. We have been resourced to help make that extreme makeover for our community. The question is, are you willing to do your part? The king is coming, John said. Are we preparing the way? Let's bow our heads for a moment as we prepare for the sharing of Holy Communion. Likewise, after supper, he takes the cup. He asks the Lord to bless the contents of that cup and give it to the disciples on the right and on the left, and said, "Take and drink this, all of you, as it represents a new covenant that I am about to establish with you, your God." We're going to have you come down the center aisle, if you would please. There's a room up here at the kneeling rail if you would like to stop and make that a part of your worship. And then return back to your seats. If I could get two ushers to come in here with me, please. Thank you. I serve and wish to be served.
Would you stand with me, please? Page number 196 in your hymnal. It'll be on the big screen. Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, for the first please.
Thank you.